So, how many gamers are there in Malaysia? Actually, there was no research done on how many gamers are there in Malaysia. And these numbers that we get was from research done by the government to find out what is the purpose of people using internet in Malaysia. What is the purpose of internet users in Malaysia who use internet? And most of them uses, 20% of the internet users in Malaysia uses internet for gaming purpose. There are 16 million internet users in Malaysia, and 20% of them uses internet for gaming alone. But that also means that this is actually the minimum number of gamers in Malaysia, because we haven't calculated yet how many gamers are there in Malaysia that buy computers for gaming purpose, or buy handheld consoles who play games on mobiles. So these are actually the minimum amount number of gamers in Malaysia. So if we were to take the same research done by the government as the so-called guideline to figure out how many gamers are there around Southeast Asia, if we take 20% of the number of amount of gamers in Malaysia, around Southeast Asia, there are 150 million gamers in Southeast Asia. These are the so-called estimation. It might not be right, it might be wrong, but this is just an estimation based on 20% of internet users around each country. As you can see, the biggest is China, and you can see all the numbers there. Alright? So, even with these numbers, even if we can come up with a research that says that we have 3.2 million gamers in Malaysia, if you were to meet up with the government officials, if you were to meet up with corporate sponsors and tell them, we have 3.2 million gamers in Malaysia, why don't we organize esports event? Why don't we have tournaments? Why don't we organize league? And the sad thing is that when we organize leagues and tournaments for these gamers, we can't see where is this 3.2 million gamers. These 3.2 million gamers never even turn up. Don't talk about 3.2 million gamers. Even 1% of 3.2 million gamers never attend the event. If 1%, that would be around 32,000 people. And we cannot even get more than 32,000 people to attend the event. Why is that? I mean, we are giving them what they want. Why can't they come up? Why can't they join the event? Now, if we were to look at the gamers' population, most of the population of gamers are casual. 60% of them are casual. Hardcore gamers are 30%, and those who actually play for the purpose of competitive are only 10% from the market. But still, it's not bad. If 10%, then at least we can target around 20,000 people. But still, we can't even reach 1% out there. So the main reason why it just cannot be accessed is the fact that gamers are not united. It's all about your game and my game. It's all about FIFA and Winning 11. It's all about ABBA and Counter-Strike. When the fact is that we shouldn't even fight within each other. We should be united. We should support each other. Doesn't matter what games you play. It's like if you play FIFA and I play Winning 11, we should support each other. But the gamers are divided because of this fact that they only play their own game. They will not support other people's game because they don't play that game. Why should I support? But if these gamers are not united, if we cannot get all these numbers to be together, we cannot reach the 3.2 million. Because the 3.2 million gamers are formed from different, from these small groups that eventually make up the 3.2 million. And that's one of the reasons why every time we host a tournament or events and everything, we can't even get 1% out of it because the gamers are not united. And this is a very sad fact. So our first step, when we talk about making this Malaysia Esports League, is that we must get these gamers to be united, which will be explained later on. Now, the next thing that we would like to talk about is there future in esports? The basic salary in Malaysia is around 2,000 ringgit, meaning that if you were to work in Malaysia, the basic salary, the average salary is around 2,000 ringgit. If you were to earn anything below 2,000 ringgit, you are considered poor. If you were to earn below 2,000 ringgit in Kuala Lumpur, you are considered poor. So for any esports, any profession to be considered as an industry, it must have future and security. That's the reason why our parents want us to be a doctor or to be an engineer or a lawyer. Because no matter what, these professions will always have demand in the market. No matter where you are, as long as you are a doctor, as long as you're an engineer or a lawyer, you can always find a job. Now, for esports to be to get the parents to encourage their sons to go to be a programmer, or to get the gamers themselves to be encouraged to keep on playing games, they must have future and security. Well, basically, we can say that gamers must be able to buy a car. Gamers must be able to buy a house. And most importantly, I believe you guys have already seen this in your slides. Gamers must be able to get married with their hot girlfriends. Because it's a fact, okay? It's a fact that most gamers have hot girlfriends. I mean, it's a fact! It's not a joke, it's a fact, okay? Well, I'm single, so... But I have a girlfriend before. And she's hot. Yeah, but the fact is this. As a man, okay? As a man, we must be the provider for the family. And for every gamer's dream, they must be able to provide for their wives, provide for their girlfriends, whatever. It's not that their girlfriends will leave them or doesn't love them, whatever. But the fact is that as a man, we have to give our best to them. And if gamers cannot get married with their hot girlfriends, why should I be a gamer? Am I right? I might as well be a doctor, or a engineer, or a lawyer. At least I can get married. I mean, to me, marriage is important to me. I'm not sure about you guys. But the fact is that for esports to grow in any countries, esports must have future and security. So the question is, what is the basic salary of current pro gamer in Malaysia? The sad fact is that the current pro gamer in Malaysia only earns 1,000 per year. You definitely cannot get married with that top girlfriend just now. By the way, that was Cristiano Ronaldo's girlfriend. Yeah, if you don't know. So again, if Cristiano Ronaldo doesn't know vegans, he won't be able to get that off, get her. Yeah, that's Cristiano Ronaldo's girlfriend. Not only you know this.
That's not him either.
Huh?
That's not him either.
No, it's she. It's her. I Google. Yes, yes. Maybe it's a different girlfriend, I'm not so sure. Well, that also means that he can afford to have more girlfriends. Alright. So for esports to grow in any countries, esports must have future and security. Gamers must have future and security for them to go all the way out. So this is also another issue that we have to tackle when we wanted to introduce our esports league in Malaysia. So the next thing is that if I were to ask you at this moment, right now, how to actually be a pro gamer in your own country? Most of the common answers that you get, if you were to ask anyone, random people around the streets, or even gamers themselves, the most common answer was train hard, maybe win some big tournaments, and if you are good, maybe some things will come and find you and sponsor you. And I don't know, just keep on hope that one day you'll be a pro gamer. I was a gamer myself, and I would say that my achievement is not something that I would say that it's quite a good achievement. I've done a lot for Malaysia. I won 2 times gold medal in Malaysia. But the fact is that no matter how many tournaments that I've joined, no matter how big tournaments that I've won, I'm still not a pro gamer. I still cannot get married. Yeah, okay, I should stop with that. So, but the fact is that why? What's wrong? Why can't I be a pro gamer even if I won a lot of big tournaments? Even to compare with, say, football, for example, this is just a simplified way of becoming a pro footballer. You train hard since young, you join the football schools or academy, then you find a manager or a scout or everything and ask him to maybe find a club for you to join everything, and if you can prove yourself well, then you can join a club or a team. So, but at least for football, there is a systematic way for them to be a pro gamer. Whereas for us, there's no systematic way on how to be a pro gamer. There's no a way where you definitely know if you were to do this, if you were to join this tournament, you definitely know you will be a pro gamer. There's no such thing. In Malaysia at least, there's no such thing. Most people say, maybe I join WCG and get the world champion, I'll be a pro gamer. The fact is that even if, when I won WCG Asia in 2006 and 2008, not a single media covered us. Not even the government people know about us. That's how is in my country. So meaning it doesn't make any difference at all. It's just a way of bragging myself, oh, I'm the best in Asia, something like that. But at the end of the day, I just can't live being a gamer. So the next step that we need to come to think when we create our league is a systematic way for a gamer, for anyone else to be a pro gamer. Now, when we talk about a value, how do we value sportsmen? How do, say again, we compare Cristiano Ronaldo? Why is Cristiano Ronaldo so expensive? Why is he a millionaire? Why is he worth millions? Why is other players like maybe Rooney or John Terry and such can earn millions? So how do we actually rate this sportsman? Now, for players like Cristiano Ronaldo, yes, he is a good player. He's one of the best players around the world. He can score goals, a lot of players can dribble, a lot of players can, yes, I can see a lot of disapproval about Cristiano Ronaldo being a good footballer. But the reason why he is worth million is because the exposure. He has a lot of fans. Every time he played, millions of people will be watching him. When he was at Manchester United and he moved to Real Madrid, most of his fans at Manchester United followed him to Real Madrid as well. And that brings more value to him. Even players, all players like David Beckham are still worth millions because of the exposure that he can get, sponsorship that he can get, everything. It's because the exposure that he can provide to the teams that he joined. Yes, he can win, he's the best player in the team, yes. He can win the league for the teams that he joined. But the fact is that he is worth millions, not just because he is good, but because of the amount of exposure that he gets. So we can also, in a simplified way, we can also say that value is also equal to exposure. The more exposure or fans a player has, the higher his value is. So this is a little bit, I would say, challenging to some of the organizers, because actually we shouldn't give the gamers a huge cash prize. What we should give them is the most exposure, the best, the huge exposure for them. We should focus on giving them the most exposure as an organizer. Because why? Because if let's say that we can get 100,000 people to watch a match, let's say a player joined a tournament and every time he played a match, he can get 100,000 people to watch his game. With these 100,000 viewers, he can approach sponsors and ask the sponsor to maybe sponsor him 1,000, 2,000 ringgit for every time he played. Let's say that every time he played, he asked for the sponsors to sponsor him 1,000 ringgit, 2,000 ringgit per month for him to join in this league. That is for one sponsor. He can get 1,000, 2,000 ringgit from one sponsor. But what if he can get 10 sponsors? That means he can get 10 to 20,000 worth of sponsorship, cash prizes from sponsors. For if we were to make it into a year, that would be 100 to 200,000 ringgit worth of sponsorship. So as you can see, it's not just about cash prizes. If we can give them the best exposure, the most exposure that they can capitalize on, they will be able to survive by themselves. They do not have to survive to depend on us organizers. They can depend on themselves. So this is another thing that we want to introduce in our league as well. We want to ensure that the gamers doesn't just get a good cash prize, but will get the best exposure. And the most importantly, the worst thing that an organizer can do is to create an instant celebrity. That is the worst thing that you should do, because you are actually going to spend a lot of money just to create a buzz, but there won't be any future or security for the gamers anymore, because the cost of creating a huge cash prize for tournaments and leagues is very, very high. So we believe that organizers, as we should avoid from giving them huge cash prize, but instead give them a lot of exposure for them to capitalize on. So the next thing that we should think of when we create this league is to create the most exposure that the gamers can get. So the challenge in Malaysia is that there is no systematic way on how to be a pro gamer in Malaysia. The only thing that the common perception on how to be a pro gamer in Malaysia is to join tournaments like ESWC, WCG, IeSF become the best in the world and get sponsored. That's all. But that's not a systematic way. And another challenge is that in Malaysia, there are two categories of players. There are amateur players and there are professional players. So how do an amateur player become a professional player in Malaysia? It's very simple actually. All you have to do is win a lot of amateur tournaments, always dominate these tournaments until all the amateur players hate you and you get banned from joining this tournament and you are already a professional player. Yes. Once you get banned from joining amateur tournaments, you are a professional player in Malaysia. Yeah, that sounds cool, right? Wow, I'm so great. I'm being banned from joining this tournament anymore because I can dominate this tournament. I'm the best. But the fact is that when these players are being banned from joining this tournament, when organizers host open tournaments for all the people, all the players to join, nobody's going to join it because everybody wants to win. Amateurs do not want to join open tournaments because why should I join? I'm not going to win this tournament. If there are 10 pro players in this tournament, this definitely these top 10 pro players are going to dominate this tournament. So why should I join? In the end, these professional, these open tournaments are only for the professional players. But there are not many professional players in Malaysia. So in the end, these professional players, I mean, pro is just a word. It's not that they can get paid to play games. They're just pro because they are just good. But they can't do anything. There's no point for them to join. The worst thing is that if it's a team game, if it's a team that was banned by this tournament, what does this team do is that they disband. They disband and form a new team by themselves so that they can join the amateur tournament again. That's how sad it is. A good team, a professional team that are international as an international standard. In the end, they have to disband because there's not enough tournament for them to join. In the end, they have to join the amateur tournament again. That's what is happening in Malaysia. So these are the challenges that we have to solve. And it's not wrong for the amateur players to think that I shouldn't join this tournament because I'm going to lose. It's not wrong as well because it's correct. Why should I join a tournament if I'm going to lose? Because I'm putting a lot of effort in it. I'm paying for the registration fee. I must get something out from this tournament. It's not wrong for the amateur player to think like that as well. So let me introduce to you our Spotgamers Esports League, Malaysia Esports League. In Malaysia Esports League, we introduced, instead of two grade systems, amateur and professional players, we introduced a five grade system. The five grades are grade O, grade C, grade B, grade A, and grade S. Not grade S, but grade S. If you get what I mean there. Okay, so how do we categorize these five categories is based on the cash prize. The lowest cash prize is grade O and the highest cash prize is grade S. So in order for you to be a pro gamer in Malaysia, you should aim for the grade S because that's where the big cash prize is for you. Now, the reason why we created this five grade system instead of so-called a three grade system where most people commonly accept, which is amateur, semi-pro, and professional. Why we did in five grade system is because it gives time for the amateur players to develop themselves to become professional. And it's not just time that we give them, it's that the higher they go, the more that they can get. And then the grade S level is for the professional players. The grade A and grade B are for casual players who like to play competitively for the grade A, grade A. So, and grade A or grade C is for the others. It's for the lower league players who want to participate in the league but do not want to go up. So these are the grading system that we did. Grade O, grade C, grade B, grade B, grade A, and grade S. And I believe that esports is not just for the best. It's not just for the champion. Esports is not, it's not just for the top three. Esports is not just for pro players. Esports is for everyone. Everyone who does well in esports should deserve reward. Everyone who do well in esports should deserve to get something out of it. And therefore, what we did in Malaysia Esports League is that We did not just give the cash prizes to the first place. We did not just give the cash prizes to the top three. We don't just give the cash prizes to the top eight, but we also give the cash prizes to until top 16. Meaning that as long as you get into the top 16 in the league, you will get cash prizes. And this is an example of the cash prizes that we are giving for the Great C, for individual games for the Great C. What you can see here, 1,000 ringgit is actually equals to around 300 USD, somewhere around 300 to 350 USD. It might not be that much to you, but this cash prize that we offer in Malaysia is actually considered huge. It's actually considered big because this is what usually for other tournaments, big tournaments like WCG or ASWC and stuff like that in Malaysia, they offer champion 1,000 ringgit, second place they give 700 ringgit, third place they give 400 ringgit. But we increased the bar actually by giving these cash prizes for the Great C players. Even those who join the Great C players can get these cash prizes. You do not have to get the Great S to get this. As long as you're in the Great C, you can already get this. So this is for the Great B. So the higher you go, the more that you will win. So you're gonna get 2,000 ringgit, 1,004, 800, 500, 300, and 150 for the rest. This is for the Great A, and this is where the professionals player will be getting 4,000 ringgit, 2,800 ringgit, 1,006 ringgit, and so on and so forth. So this is where the professional players are going to earn. This is what they're going to earn. And this is for team games. Team games is actually the same like the individual games, just that usually team games actually have 5 members in it. Each member, so we just times 5 from the individual games. So this is team B, 10,000 ringgit for the champion. Grade A is 15,000 ringgit, and grade S is 20,000 ringgit. So, how do you get promoted from each grade? How from a player from grade S, from grade C, gets promoted to grade B? It's very simple. All you have to do is get into the top 64. You do not need to get that high. As long as you get into the top 64, you will be promoted. The reason why we do this is because we want to encourage people that as long as you do well in esports, as long as you have a good performance in esports, you deserve to get promoted. So this is the points that we give for the champions: 12 points, second place, third place, and fourth place, as you can see on the screen. So as I said again, esports is for everyone. It's not just for the top three or the few professional players. This is for everyone who does well. So in order for us to make this success, in order for us to make esports a reality in Malaysia, what we need to do is that we have to increase the frequency of organizing this league. From 3 times per year to every month. We are planning to organize this league in November this year until December, and we're going to start it again in March next year until April, and again in May next year until June. So if you were to organize it every month, the idea is that you were to organize it in January, then we're going to take a break on February, then we're going to start again on March, then we're going to take a break again in April, then we're going to start again in May, then we'll take a break in June, and so on and so forth. So, 1 month play, 1 month break. The reason why we do this is because the league can actually be a place where they can actually earn a living. Because as you can see from the prices that we give, it's actually considered a lot for the gamers. And if they can actually survive just by playing in our league, that's how we can make esports a reality. And by increasing the frequency of organizing the league, by increasing the frequency of organizing the league, you actually increase the time, you actually shorten the time for the players to get to the highest level. So that's the reason why you want to increase the frequency of the league. If you can increase the frequency of the league, then you'll be successful. The next thing we want to do is that we want to increase the number of gamers that join our website to 100,000 people. The reason why 100,000 people is because 100,000 people is an industry standard in Malaysia. If you have 100,000 members in your website, you can start selling advertisement on your website. At least there is something that you can start to capitalize on 100,000 people. And with 100,000 people, if let's say that we can get around 20 to 30% of them to watch our league, so we have 20,000 to 30,000 people who watch our league, then there is something that they that the players themselves can capitalize on. They can start to find their own sponsor and tell the sponsors, we have 20,000 to 30,000 people who watch our league, who watch us when we play, and can you then they can ask for sponsorship. So our target is to get 100,000 people to join our league. As I say again, it's not about the exposure. It's not about the cash prize, but the exposure. If you were to compare our cash prize to other big tournaments like MLG or IEM or other big tournaments like IeSF as well, it's actually very small. What we give is actually very little. The reason why is because we want to focus on the exposure. The more exposure these gamers get, the more they can profit from it. Then the next thing is that we want to increase the number of games to be included in our league. The reason is because we want to get the gamers to be united. The more games that we can host in our league, the more gamers can join, and the more happier they will be because their games are included. For the start, for the first season, we actually selected 4 games. 2 games we selected, and another 2 games we let the gamers to decide. So for us, we have selected FIFA and Dota, and the other 2 games that the gamers have selected was Counter-Strike and StarCraft 2. So these are the 4 games that will start in Malaysia this positive. So thank you for your time. Again, I would like to thank IeSF for giving me this opportunity to present it to you today. And this will be a very interesting journey for us in Malaysia, because this will be the time where we want to host our Malaysia Esports League, and we hope that it will be successful in the future. So again, my name is Rinie Ramli, and I'm from Malaysia. And today will be the day where where Esports will be a reality in Malaysia. Thank you. Any questions? Science. The girl just now. Yes.
Yes, thank you for the presentation. You were talking about a lot of money. Where do you get the money? Because I did a little bit of a calculation, and it's more than $650,000 only to have one individual game and one team game. And you're talking about spending more money on exposure than on cash prizes. So you're talking about a lot of money. Where do you get that money?
Oh, okay. Well, I can honestly tell you that we do not have all this money are actually from my own pocket. Huh? Yes, everything is from my own pocket because I have my own business, so I'm actually investing in this concept. Yeah. So, but actually, it's not that much actually. If you actually calculate for the first season, we're actually going to spend around 100,000 ringgit for operating the entire league. So it's actually not that big. It's only 100,000 ringgit. Actually, it's a big for us, but it's not that big. Yeah.
So it's more future plans and not short term.
Yes, it's more on the long term plan, because we feel that esports can only reach its level in the next 20 years. Because the fact is that at this current moment, if we are not doing anything at this moment, esports will not be a reality. So we decided to do it differently this time. We decided to not just do a league where we give them a big cash prize and everything. Instead, we want to focus on the future. We want to focus on getting the exposure for them, creating an industry for the gamers. So, like you said, it's actually more for the future.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Anyone else? You don't have to ask questions if you don't want to. You can ask later, personally. Yeah.
Hi. Basically, first a short question, probably then I don't have to ask the other one. Regarding your different grades, are there participant limitations inside, or is it as many people as they want to participate?
Okay, at this moment, we're actually going to host the event, the league, in our eSports stadium. We actually have an eSports stadium in Malaysia called Micron. In this stadium, we actually have more than 100 PCs, and we also have 220 megabyte lines. That's the fastest internet line in Malaysia. And we also have, we can do live streams and stuff like that. So at this moment, we're actually limiting the number of players to 128 for each game. For individual games, it's 100 players, and for team game, it's 128 teams.
Okay, so if you promote 64 players, you drop out 64 players as well from that grid?
We don't drop, they remain at the same grid. So meaning that only the, let's say that you are in grid C, right, and we have 128 players, right? So the top 64 will go up. So the rest of the 64 will stay at the grid C. So then when we start the new season, the new players will come into the grid C.
Okay.
Yeah.
Then I'm wondering regarding the motivation, because for example, if you're at grade B and you're champion, you win 2,000, and if you then will be promoted,
yes,
probably you will be not good enough there to get into the prize money ranges, then it would be better for you to stay in the lower grades. I think it's a bit the same problem with banning pro gamers out of amateur leagues to benefit from the raising motivation. So how do you handle that in a bigger league or in a higher league, you could win less than in the lower league?
Yes, okay. So for the start, for the beginning, what we're going to do is that everyone who gets 64 will get promoted. They have no choice but to get promoted. This is what we're going to do first. Because as you know, if you want to give options to these gamers, they definitely will choose the options that will benefit them more than benefit the esports. So we are not going to give them any options but to get promoted if they get to the top 64. If they want to stay at the same league, then it's better that they just don't join this league. This is not for you. This is not a place where you only think about yourself. This is a place where we make esports a reality.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
디지털 문화연구소 이장주 소장님께서 국제 e스포츠 심판 양성 프로그램에 대해